Hi, this is John Colo with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you coming at you from my beautiful backyard garden here in January. And in this episode, we're going to answer your guys' questions. I apologize, I'm not available personally to answer any questions at this time. I was doing a Fiverr, but Fiverr like blocked my account or something I got to figure out. So you don't have there's no way to contact me personally to answer your questions at this time. But what I do is I do like to basically take questions that you guys submit to me through my YouTube community page, which is the link is right down below this video. You can submit a question there and it may appear in next month's organic gardening Q&A they like to have to kind of, you know, get your guys' questions answered. My time is very valuable to me and I'm running all over the place trying to produce YouTube videos and keep my garden growing, prepare my food, and do everything else I have to do in my life, which includes, you know, now food prep and help my parents out, you know, because they moved, you know, more close to me, you know, and it takes a lot of time. So I apologize that, you know, people expect an answer from me. I simply am one guy. I edit my videos, I film my videos, I do it all, and I ain't Superman either. All right, so anyways, on to this month's questions. First question is from HJHJ Hook. Distilled tap or filtered water for plant watering? So that's a good question. Like, I would choose option C or D, the one that's not in there. Rainwater! I like rainwater is the best water for watering your plants. And, you know, I don't know, are you watering your outside garden? You know, distilled water would be a waste, in my opinion. If you're having a hydroponic system inside where you want to control the minerals and all this kind of stuff, that might be a good thing to do. You know, I grow outside and rain, which we got rain a couple weeks ago. You know, is the best water for plants, in my opinion, because it's basically nature's water, and that's basically it. As to the ones that you've asked about, distilled, tap, or filtered, what do I use? Well, I use actually tap water that has been filtered. You know, they add things in a tap water to make it safe for human consumption, so we don't have outbreaks of different kinds of bacterias and Giardias and cryptosporidiums, which is probably a good thing. But it's not good, optimally, in my opinion, for the soil or for the plants. With, you know, adding in things like high levels of fluoride and chlorine, or even worse, chloramine, that is in there designed to kill microbes, right? I want to encourage microbial growth in my garden. So, you know, then it says filtered water. So there are many different kinds of filters, and I'll say you need to get a good filter for your specific environment. You know, the main things that municipalities put in the water are the chloramine and chloramines, or the chlorine, and you know, those could be easily removed. So I definitely say a good filtered water. I'll have an upcoming video on actually enhancing the water even over above just removing some things. That'll be a whole nother episode that may be controversial for some, but I believe it can be helpful, and it's at least not going to harm your plants and probably help them. Next question is from Julie Barquin. I live in zone 12 now. I was in 10B until 1 year ago. I'm struggling with finding the right things to plant, let alone things I would like to eat. Any advice? All right, Julie, so I don't know what zone 12 you're in. I can maybe think it's Hawaii. Hey, if you move to Hawaii, that's great. I love Hawaii. Hawaii is wonderful. And there are so many cool things you guys can grow in Hawaii or other zone 12. And I would encourage you to watch some of my videos where I visit Zone 12 gardens and people growing in Zone 12. I have plenty of videos on Hawaii. I go there usually once a year. I missed going there in 2020 due to the virus. And I have a trip planned for later this year if things are clear up or whatever. But yeah, so grow things that are going to grow well in your zone, you know, from zone 10B. Yeah, some of those things that will grow in zone 10B will grow in zone 12, but some of them may not. So I would say find the new plants that grow well in your area. And, you know, finding things that you would like to eat, I mean, that's just a different discussion topic. I mean, we're all used to what we're used to eating. I mean, I have a whole bed of lettuce here, right? And I get to enjoy lettuce in the wintertime. Summertime, I don't eat any of my homegrown lettuce because it simply ain't growing. It'd be too much of an uphill battle. And likewise, in zone, you know, 12, you're not going to eat some of the crops that you're used to eating in like a northern climate. And that's fine. You need to eat seasonally and also eat locally. So you're going to get to learn about new flavors and new taste sensations that I would encourage you to look into. I mean, I think it's wonderful, all, a lot of the different Zone 12 edibles. There are so many cool plants that I love to eat, even more than some of my ones that I get to grow here in Zone 9. Although, I really like a variety, and that's why I like to travel around so that I could eat things from Zone 12 when I'm there, and I could get to come back to my garden, eat things, and enjoy things here. Because, you know, every different food is so amazing, a different wealth of phytonutrients, vitamins, and minerals, and flavor, and taste sensations. All right? Next question is from Steve Koninski. John, do you use activated biochar in your beds? I make my own and activate it in my beds. I learned this from your videos. Do you think it has benefits? Yes, I use biochar. Actually, I get a pre-activated biochar. It's from OGS, Organic Garden Solution, that makes the worm castings that I use. Basically, they inoculate their worm castings, which, you know, probably the best worm castings that I found to date, with biochar. They inoculate it for you, and then they basically, I get a bag from them, and I just mix some of that into my beds every year when I top them off. I do believe they have a benefit. You know, they are rich in carbon. They provide home for the microbes and, you know, lots of different things. So I would say that I think it is good, but it's very important to activate it like you are doing. I would prefer to activate it not inside the beds, because if it's not activated, it can actually suck or hold in nutrients, okay? Next question is from First Last. Hi, John. Besides microgreens, what other edible plants a novice could grow inside? That's a good question. So, sprouts. Easiest one, even over above microgreens. Sprouts are super simple. Some of the sprouts that I grow are done in just literally 1 or 2 days. That's the easiest, okay? After that, I would then say herbs would be another easy one. Some herbs, just make sure you don't overwater them, such as basil, such as sage, such as rosemary, that grow outside amazingly here in my climate. But herbs are also very valuable because of their essential oils. Also, you don't generally use a lot of herbs when you're cooking or preparing or eating it or harvesting. The next thing I would say is our leafy greens. So grow some rocket, you know, arugula. Arugula grows quite fast. Grow that in soil. You know, the leafy greens are always going to be the easiest, because literally you grow a plant, you pick the leaf and you eat it. Whereas something like a tomato or pepper or cucumber, they actually have to grow all the leaves, and then the plant has to grow the flowers, and the plant flowers have to get pollinated. Some will pollinate on their own. Some you have to have some intervention, and then it makes the fruit. So it's a lot longer process. So for novices, stick the sprouts, the microgreens, the herbs, and the leafy greens, especially those fast growing ones. All right. Next question is from Tonette Harbs. I live on 1 acre of land in Texas, and I recently watched your video on the best way to eat moringa is to drink it. I've never grown a garden. My question is, what are some good beginning plants, vegetables, or fruits to grow? So, you know, Texas is a diverse climate depending on where in Texas you live. I've made several videos in the Houston area, maybe one or two in the Dallas area, maybe a few in the Austin area. So the plants that you want to grow down there are the plants that are available at, generally, Asian nurseries near you, right? The Asian nurseries, grow plants that are similar to the climate you have there in many parts, but not all parts of Texas. So look up my videos on best plants for Texas, and my videos should come up, or watch all my videos that I've made for Texas in the past. I made videos at my ex-girlfriend's parents' house, and some of the plants that I planted there that they basically now can't get rid of, and those are the plants that I personally would grow because they're very easy and low maintenance and not gonna be bothered by pests, because they pretty much don't do anything to them except maybe water them sometimes, okay? Let's see. Electric Ninja. Hey, John, what can I do about never-ending bombardment of rats eating my collards and generally decimating my garden? I place rat traps, but I live in the hills and I can't keep up, apparently. I can't have a cat, and there are wild bobcats nearby seeming not to do their job. Help. All right. So, Electric Ninja, so you can't have cats. So, like, number one is I would want to have predators for the rats that would do the catching so that you don't have to. I mean, traps will do that for you, but they're not necessarily that smart. They're dumb. And some traps could reset on their own, and that'd probably be a good thing instead of those snap traps that you have to reset. You know, they have ones with a little piston thing that comes down and fires and knocks them in the head, which, you know, it's kind of cruel to animals, I suppose, if you're into being vegan. But the other thing is the rats are eating your food, and can spread disease and all these other things. So, you know, if you're a vegan, then you probably wouldn't want to do any of these things because, you know, if you're a vegan, this is what you're going to do. If you're a vegan, then you're going to cover your plants with fine mesh chicken wire, or not even chicken wire because maybe the rats could bite through that. You need a thick galvanized, you know, fine mesh to put over everything to keep the rats out. And then you could let them be on their way and hopefully they'll go somewhere else, or they'll get rambunctious and figure out how to get past your wiring and get in. and that's a decision for you to decide. But there are some non-toxic bait traps you can use, such as Rat X. I met the company at a trade show. I didn't personally care for the employees or potentially even the owner of the company, but their product, which is basically, based around corn gluten or something like that, basically is non-harmful to other animals that are not in the rodent family, but will kill rats, mice, and I think even rabbits and stuff. So you could use that. Not harmful to dogs or cats. You could also get an owl box. So owl is one of the biggest predators of rats and rodents, and they are out when the rodents are out, which is at night, right? So I would put up many owl boxes around your property and encourage owls to come. Put them at different heights, put them in different colors, put them at different sun facings, and look up how to place owl boxes, because I surely do not know. the other thing is, yeah, build fencing around it and enclose it. Also, there's some other creatures besides owls that will eat the rats that are not cats, since you can't have cats. Can you have dogs? Well, then get a rat terrier. Rat terriers, not all rat terriers will go after rats, but rat terriers were originally bred to get rats, you know? And so have a whole herd of rat terriers, and I encourage you guys to get them from a rescue somewhere. Or you could get rat snakes. So there's snakes that actually just feed on rats and eat rats. And I don't know if they're native to where you live, because you didn't say where you live, but in some places they are native, and actually relocating even native snakes can be illegal. So if you could find some, I don't know, somehow get your hands on some rat snakes or introduce them into your environment, if it's okay to do so and not gonna violate any laws, that might be another good idea for you. So, and the other thing is, plant plants that rats don't like to eat, right? Biggest tip, right? I'm sure there's wild stinging nettles or wild dandelions and wild, I don't know what grows in your area that are wild and edible, and rats pass by those all the time because they're so common. They're like, oh, dandelions, I don't like those. They taste bitter, and they go by them. But like, oh, this guy's growing collard greens. That's like eating cake for them. So just grow more edibles that they don't like in your garden so that you can eat from your garden instead of the rats, all right? Next question is from a home garden tech. Hello, sir, I'm in India and I have to start my gardening channel. Can you tell me some tips for my channel growth? Well, get started soon. You know, I got started luckily on my YouTube channel on gardening before most other popular gardeners did these days. So that's number one, I have time on my side. Number two, I would say, you know, you want to have a mix of, you know, kind of rare, isolated topics, archaic topics that nobody else has, because then if you have that one weird, isolated topic that nobody talks about, that's why I try to have weird topics on my channel, number one, but also I'm a weird guy and I do weird things in my garden, not like normal gardeners would do in some cases. You could basically own that category, you know? So that's one of the tips I would give you. Just have like some, you know, different videos that most people, you know, in your city, in your country do not have. So when people are looking that up, you're going to be the only guy that has it that'll drive traffic to that video alone. That video alone will basically show YouTube that, wow, this guy makes popular videos, and then they'll rank higher your other videos. In addition, be consistent. That's very important. I try to, you know, my goal was to do 2 videos a week on this channel, and every 3 to 5 days, and I'm just not able to do that. So I try to do 1 video a week, but that's the bare minimum. More the better. Also, you probably should have some live shows every once in a while. I heard that could help with the analytics. I haven't kept up too much to date with the YouTube analytics because, frankly, my goal is not to, you know, be popular on YouTube. My goal is to make a difference in the world and change gardeners' lives, and that's why videos tend to be long. And the other thing is, actually, you might want to actually not have videos as long as mine to get better ranked in YouTube. I think they've been disranking, you know, people with super long videos that actually don't get watched through all the way to the end. So it'd be better to have shorter videos that get watched all the way through the end than long videos that don't necessarily get watched to the end. If you want to be popular on YouTube, My goal is to spread good information to people, and I know the people that are looking for my information, that are interested in it, appreciate my long videos because of all the detail that I go into that people are just simply not going to learn in a 5 or 10 minute video where people aren't getting enough information. And without all the proper information, then, you know, people do things that are just not justified in my personal opinion. I'll leave it at that. All right. And then let's see, next question is from ADV Nevada. What suggestions do you have for someone who must leave their garden for a couple of weeks at a time? I'm in Southern Nevada. Already have a drip system. So actually I would know because actually this used to be my vacation house because I'd go back to California and live there. And then I'd come out here maybe once a month. So I would literally leave for months at a time. And I had a drip system. Actually, it's the same. This bed is one of the original beds I put in. I think this guy right here on a drip system. I have a hose end timer over there. And I would say create redundant systems. Very important, right? Also have a system that does not have batteries. Hopefully it plugs into your wall and maybe even have a battery backup system. Depends on how important your garden is to you. You know, at one point, my garden timer, like when the batteries went out or something, and then maybe my water didn't get watered. I lost everything. One time, my irrigation system, the valve stuck on the on position, and my garden basically was getting water like 24/7 for I don't know how many weeks, and it was flooded back here when I got back. But my tree collards were the biggest ever seen, which proved to me you can't really overwater certain items. So I would say, number one, install one of those water flow meters. You know, now they have water flow meters, so you can see if you have a leak. That's very important. Number two, put in redundant systems, so if that if one timer should fail, you have a backup system in place that could basically kick in. You know, when I was doing all this, they didn't have like Wi-Fi controlled water timers, and now I got all this Wi-Fi so I could travel. The other thing is put up cameras, which I've also done, so you could kind of monitor and see if things are garden, if are growing and whatnot, so that you have, you are, you know, gonna be safe when you travel to kind of keep an eye on your place and also know what's happening with the watering system through flow meters and by looking at your plants and also, you know, being able to control the water timers remotely. All right, those are my best suggestions for you. Next is from Auth. What are some of the best ways to propagate Okinawan spinach that you have found? So the best way I found is through a cloning machine, right? Cloning machines, I mean, the one I got is made by Hydro Farm these days. I think it's called the OxyFlow, I think. I forget the name. But basically, I have videos. I don't know if I remember. I'll post the link down below if I remember. But basically, I clone my basically water spinach that I buy from the Asian market every spring in the cloner, and actually I probably should get some started pretty soon, and then basically grows roots, and then I plant in my garden. So I've also done Gynera procumbens in there. I think I've also done some Okinawan spinach, which is Gynera bicolor, pretty much the same way, and that's the best way. I put a little bit of rooting hormone in there into the water, and it just works great. I mean, the other way is the lazy way, which is basically just stick a cutting in a pot that's in my flood table, and it just gets watered, and then it grows. And so, I mean, I'm pretty laissez-faire about some of these things. I don't, like, need to grow plants because I'm not trying to sell them. And sometimes I'll do cuttings when I have time and, you know, whatever. All right, floor nugs. Will adding silica to my raised bed gardens affect or harm the microbial population? That's a good question. Sounds like a question for a microbiologist, which I am not. I'm just a home gardener. You know, I've made several videos on silica in the past. And, you know, here's the thing, we want to add silica in nature's proportion. So I like to add azomite rock dust, which is actually high in silica, which is basically a clay powder or a rock powder. It has lots of different minerals, but it has silica along with other minerals in there at the same time in a proper percentage in the garden. And then I personally believe that adding rock dust to your garden will increase your microbial content. Now, I don't know what kind of silica you want to add, you know, and I'd say as long as it's not like in too high amounts or in one spot, you know, I believe that to be a beneficial thing for your garden. I mean, literally, the plant's backbones, like our backbones are made out of calcium, literally. The backbones of the plants are made out of silica. Very important to get silica in your garden. And more importantly than the silica are the bacteria that break down the silica to make it plant available. How could you get those? Well, Elaine Ingham would say add, you know, there's silica already in your garden and the microbes will find it, but if you add silica, that'll encourage more of those microbes to come because of more of the food that's in there. Like if you have a trash can full of garbage, you know, and then the rats will come and eat it. If you leave the top open, you leave it out too long, but if you don't have the trash can with garbage, they're not gonna come, right? So add the silica and you're gonna get you know, better microbe populations, in my opinion, to an extent, because if you put too much silica, then you're going to imbalance the whole system. So that's why I like to use Nature's Proportions fertilizers, which is like, you know, things that are naturally made, like worm castings and rock dust. All right, next question is from a recreant. If you could only grow with grow tents through a traditional American winter, what plants would you grow for quality nutrition saving money? So I'm assuming that you mean grow tents like inside your house, because it's too cold in the winter. So for quality nutrition and saving money, I would easily grow microgreens. I've said this many times before, best plant to grow inside is microgreens. If you price out microgreens, they're quite expensive per ounce, and you could easily set up a system that you can grow and supply yourself literally a tray, or better yet, two trays a day of microgreens, and those could meet some of your, you know, vegetable or leafy green requirements. Microgreens are also very nutritious, even more so than my outside vegetables. And one of my goals is to find a partner that likes to grow microgreens inside, because I'm really good at the outside stuff. But the microgreens, man, honestly, I never got the hang of it. Maybe one of these days I got a few kits that I want to use that are basically just hands-off kits. So, like, you know, I can't be tending my stuff every day. I got so many other things. I'm ping-ponging everywhere, and as you travel a lot, and just dealing with microgreens and taking care of them a few times a day, it's just not my style. So I could plant my plants once, get them in an irrigation system, and then get them growing, and they're going to be fine. But I can't do microgreens. But yeah, so microgreens, sprouts, which you don't even need a grow tent. I mean, after that, I would definitely say, you know, once again, leafy greens and herbs, I think, are the best things, especially perennial leafy greens that you could grow year-round and bring out in the summertime. Like, I would grow some tree collards in there that'll make leaves. But the thing is, if you're serious about eating like food out of your garden, yeah, tree collard will produce leaves. But you know, it takes a while for them to produce leaves, and then to be able to eat one leaf off the plant, you know, it's not really realistic to grow a lot of food. I think at that point, it's more of a hobby kind of thing, personally. All right. Next question is from JQLN Reichart. Hi, John. Love your videos. I was hoping you could help me out. I remember using Gaia Green products, namely their worm castings. Do you happen to have any sources in the U.S. for their fertilizers? Thanks. All right. So I was not aware that I used Gaia Green worm castings. I was using Gaia Green rock dust that I sourced in Santa Rosa, California at the time. The Gaia Green rock dust is kind of difficult to find. There's a distributor, I think it's maybe Down to Earth or maybe Spare Time Supply, that basically will bring that stuff in from Canada. I've never used their worm castings, and I have not tested them. Gaia Green is basically a company in Canada, so they have very limited distribution into the U.S. from what I'm aware. And I think on the West Coast, you'd have far better luck sourcing some of their products. That being said, you know, after learning more about the Gaia Green glacial rock dust and seeing some of the assays on it, you know, while that stuff is good, and definitely if you can get it, use it, you know, there are other rock dust products that I prefer now over that since the time I made those original videos. I've never used their worm castings, and I believe there are far better worm castings than what they are selling. I don't know exactly what they're selling, but most worm castings aren't that good, in my personal opinion, for my testing. I do recommend the OGS worm castings. I also recommend the Worm Gold Plus worm castings, which are my two favorite castings, and also the worm castings from Texas, which I made a video about. I like those, but they get a bit more spendy. All right. Next question is from Nikki Z19. Hello, thank you for the inspiration. Your garden looks amazing. I have a few questions. Where do you purchase the seeds from? So I purchase seeds from all over, you know, like rare seeds, and I get seeds at different trade shows and whatnot. But honestly, I'll tell you, I don't really, all these plants, for the most part, not really grown by seeds. Maybe there's a few in here that are grown by seeds. Maybe like in the bed that you guys can't see behind the camera. I grow the Bloody Dock from seeds. This tree collards that's out of the shot are from seeds. The tree collards over there from seeds that actually I grew myself, because this plant's dropped seeds and they just grew and came up. You know, I don't tend to just, you know, collect seeds and grow them due to my usually hectic schedule. I travel a lot. Plus, you know, I'll be the first to tell you that I'm not the best seed starter in the world. You know, I get impatient like most Americans these days. And I like to buy little transplant plant starts that I basically pop in, and then they grow faster, And usually when things are sprouting up from seeds, they could get too leggy, they could get too much sun, they get not enough sun, they get too much water, not enough water, and I don't like to deal with all that stuff, honestly. You know, I support a local nursery that, you know, I buy plants from, that then I plant them in my garden, and I have food to eat. Luckily, they have a fairly wide variety. I will have an upcoming episode on maybe some the best seed catalogs, hopefully. That has been my goal. I was not able to get to it last year. Hopefully this year I will. Do you grow the plants from seed yourself? Most of the plants that you're seeing in the shot here are not grown from seed. Actually, you know what? There's a few plants that are in the back that are from seed. So there's certain things that I do grow from seed, but I don't necessarily grow them from seed myself. Nature does. I usually let seeds drop in my garden and they basically just come up and that's what comes up. I don't knowingly, try to start things from seeds only on rare occasion if it's some rare plants that I cannot get as live plants, but I prefer to source live plants myself, because I'm going to have a much higher probability of success, and more importantly, I don't have to baby my baby plants. Baby plants are harder to take care of than adult plants, and, you know, some things I just simply don't have a priority to learn or figure out at this point in my life. One day I will, and actually I do have some methods to grow from seeds. I'll post links down below if I remember. It's the Orta Seed Starter, and I will be using that again soon to start some rare seeds that I sourced. And that makes it really easy because you fill it up with water, you don't have to remember the water them, it gives it the right amount of water. You put the seeds in there and they basically put some lights on it and they just germinate and come up. And that's my way to start seeds right there. We live in Houston area and I believe it is considered zone 9. Should we be able to grow some greens? Yes, you can grow many greens. So if you're in Houston, please look up the nursery, JRN Nursery. I made a video about it. Those are the plants you want to grow that are available at JRN Nursery. They have literally curated the best plants to grow in Houston. You know, a lot of the plants that are common to most of the United States will not grow in Houston due to your unique weather that you guys have there. I would recommend growing a winter garden in Houston. You should be able to do it without any issues. Next question is from LV Home Garden. Hi, I found your page when I started gardening in April of 2020 here in Las Vegas. I was just wondering if you had any tips to someone who is new at gardening and has to deal with the Las Vegas weather. All right, number one, grow in the off season. The off season here is everything but the summertime. You know, the winter, I mean, this is my winter garden in January. I mean, it's basically full of stuff. Things don't grow quite as quick, but you don't have the pest pressures that you know of the super hot weather to deal with, right? And we rarely get frost, so that's really nice. Although all my plants that you guys are seeing in the shot are 100% frost tolerant, because the ones that ain't frost tolerant, like the, you guys can't see it back there, but it's just fried up because it just lost its life. But the main tips are, number one, put in an irrigation system. Don't depend on yourself to water stuff in the heat of the summer. You may have to water several times a day to keep your soil cool, to give your plants water, to remain hydrated, and to be able to cool themselves off. Number two, grow the right plants. This is very important. If you go to the local nursery, Star Nursery, as much as a lot of these plants were sourced at Star Nursery this winter, I'm not a big fan of Star Nursery because they'll sell you plants that are, you know, literally grown in California and sell them here, and they will not do well in our weather climate here. I know because I've tried many of them in the past. This includes most of the varieties of tomatoes, in my personal opinion. Unless you're the tomato lady and you have special techniques to do, I'm just a guy, just like plant stuff, see what happens, and I don't want to try to like micromanage my tomato plants just so I can have a couple tomatoes. Now, you know, you could put up a shade cloth. I'm not a big fan of shade cloths. I do shade half my garden. It gives me a little bit better flexibility. But, you know, this half of my garden is never under shade in the summertime, and it always grows fine. So you got to, you know, determine, you know, the plants to grow. The right plants could grow easily. That's why you should watch my videos. It was my biggest tip. I have plenty of videos on the plants that grow exactly super well in Las Vegas. And, you know, focus on the ones that you do. Also, watch all my tour videos. My tour videos are a wealth of knowledge. You might just think I'm going around and showing you what I'm growing, but you could get ideas for my tour videos. You watch all my summer tour videos. Oh, why every summer does John grow lots of peppers, but he barely grows any tomatoes? Or, you know, he might grow one bed of eggplant, you know? Why does he grow okra? What, you know, you'll learn, you'll see patterns like, oh, John always grows this. Just grow what I grow and you're going to be more successful. Why does John say grow water spinach in the summertime as the number one green to grow in Las Vegas? Because it grows amazing. It goes out of control. Now, once it freezes, it's totally out of the picture. But, you know, in the summertime, it goes hog wild. And if you kill water spinach, then, you know, you got to learn some better skills. All right. I think those are the main things. Oh, and then make sure you get the best soil possible. It is very difficult to source good soil in Las Vegas. I have videos on the topic already. That being said, I do amend my soul with many ingredients that some people would say are not necessary. You know, for my goals, they are necessary because I'm growing the highest quality food. I just don't want to grow any old food using any old soil, especially if it's made out of sewage sludge. All right. Next question is from Donald York. I came across your YouTube channel and I know nothing about microgreens. Is it safe just to eat microgreens? I do eat chicken and beef for protein. All right. So I'm glad to say I do not eat chicken or beef for protein. That is my personal choice. I'm never going to push any of my decisions on my life on you, but I will share my views on this topic. So, you know, I believe that chicken and beef, especially from CAFOs, can be far more contaminated with E. coli and bacteria and be potentially problematic than microgreens. I have not heard of any kind of people getting sick from eating microgreens, and the reason why is because you're cutting the plant off and harvesting only all the new growth. You're not harvesting the seeds. You know, people have gotten sick from sprouts in the past from contamination of E. coli on the seeds, you know, probably from bird droppings on non-sterilized seeds. So that's why you need to buy sprouting seeds for sprouting, because they have been basically properly treated and or handled and or actually more importantly microbial tested for bacteria. I would also recommend using sprouting seeds for microgreens if you want to just ensure that you're safe. You know, if you ask yourself, what does the chicken or the cow get its protein from? Well, you know, cows and chickens don't make protein out of thin air. They eat. Cows should be eating lots of grass to make their protein. Greens have a lot of protein in them. The problem is most people do not eat enough grass. I rarely eat grass. I take some wheatgrass powder. Oh, I'm going to be juicing sugar cane, which is another grass, in a little bit today. But yeah, so we need to eat lots of greens, and that's why my whole garden is covered in greens. I eat my greens for protein. I do not choose to eat, you know, cows or chickens for my protein. If you guys want to, hey, more power to you, but I would encourage you guys, if you guys eat cows or chickens, please grow them yourself and do not support big CAFOs. Because you just simply don't know how the cow was grown or treated, or the antibiotics or the GMO foods it is eating. Unfortunately, most cows and CAFOs are eating GMO corn and soy, which is not their normal diet, which causes other issues. But back to microgreens. So I think microgreens are completely safe to eat when grown properly and appropriately. And me personally, I would substitute all the microgreens in the world for the animal products for the protein. And why? Well, number one, when you're eating microgreens, you're not getting foreign proteins that can upset people's immune system, that could also increase the rate of cancer growth. In addition, the main issue I have with the animal products is that it, more importantly, it does not contain the plant phytonutrients that the plants do. You know, right here in this bed, I have broccoli and some kale. Back there, I have some cauliflower. The brassica family plants have anti-cancer properties. You know, it is shown in studies that animal products can speed up the growth of cancer, whereas it's also shown in studies that things like broccoli, microgreens especially, or broccoli sprouts can kill cancer. So, you know, I'm going to get my protein and eat things that are going to kill cancer. One of the biggest killers today is actually cancer. If you guys still eat meat, I'm not going to dissuade you from not eating it, but what I do believe personally is that everybody should adopt a mostly plant-based diet, eating mostly plants. If you want to have some meat as a side dish, you know, every once in a while, raise them yourself and kill them yourself. And I know vegans that are watching me don't like me to say that. But at least what I think is this. I think that honestly, people have to raise their own animals and kill it. I mean, I think there'd be a lot more vegans out there because I believe that people would not want to kill animals to eat them. Although, you know, some of you guys are hunters and all that, and you guys will do that. And I respect you guys for doing that. You know, I wouldn't do that myself. But I think it's really, literally a cheap shot for people just going buying the meat that's already prepackaged in the store, buying it, opening it, and eating it because they don't have any connection with the food. They don't know how it was raised. They don't know the process, you know, and animals are just basically a number, which I don't think animals should be numbers personally. All right, the next question is from Lowell Lee. I recall watching your video on worm casting compost. What is the recommended worm feed to make the ratios? All right, so that's a good question. So I don't know. I don't remember that. So I would recommend watching a link down below. It's basically how the best worm castings are made, and I visit OGS, or Organic Garden Solution, and they basically make some of the best castings that I've had the best results in my garden, and look up the formula. I go over there and I say they use this, and I don't know if I say the ratios, you know, but those are the ingredients you want to use. Some of the ones that come to the top of my head are very important, which are basically a chitin source such as crab or shrimp shells or broken down into the finest particulate size as possible and have lots of carbonaceous matter, such as like a cardboard, shredded cardboard, very important. Also, there's lots of other things they put in there, but basically the more different components you put in, you know, the more the nutritious the end supply, and also, you know, the more different nutrients you give the worms, the more they're gonna produce different enzymes in their guts and put that into their poop, which are then basically the biologics that are gonna basically work in your garden to make the worm castings work better. All right, last question is actually kind of long from Julio Calderon Jr. Hello, John, love all your very informative videos. I came across Alberta Urban Garden Trial Tests on YouTube and on rock dust and biochar that they do not really hold up to controlled growing, and they do not hold up as far as they say. I really believe in remineralizing the soil to keep us healthy. Wanted to know your thoughts on that, please. Also, is it just better to put rock dust in compost instead? Also, what about azomite? Can it be also be put into compost, or is it better to just mix in the soil? Thanks. Thank you. I appreciate your time. Julio, San Diego. All right, Julio. So, you know, I made a video. Basically, I visited Tom, the rockdustlocal.com guy. If I remember, put a link down below to that video where I discuss why rock dust doesn't work. And we answer these questions in detail from a rock dust expert horse's mouth. Well, he's not a horse, but you know, direct to you guys. So, you know, what I know is this, right? Rock dust is not immediately absorbed by the plants. I admit that, you know, totally true. It's too big a particle size. It needs to get broken down. If you don't have good microbial action in your garden because you're just growing with synthetic fertilizers your whole life, your garden is not in a good state to be breaking down the rock dust. So you need to add microbial inoculants, which I also recommend. You also need to add things like worm castings that'll add the microbes in there. You know, add things like compost tea that'll get the minerals in the rock dust broken down, as well as other minerals already existing in the compost broken down and being able to be more utilized from the plant. Rock dust is more of a long-term end-game solution. If you want a more immediate uptake of trace minerals in the soil, absolutely. Use some kind of like ocean solution or ocean solids, C90, whatever you guys got, sea crop, you know, or use some kind of, you know, a kelp spray, some foliar spray, use some of the phytoplankton I showed a couple episodes ago. That'll give you a more immediate uptake of some of the trace minerals than rock dust would. Yes, we should use both kinds of trace minerals in the soil and also from like a foliar feed as well to encourage more microbial growth, because some microbes might like the foliar and the ones in the kelps and whatnot, and some might like the rock dust, and it's going to grow different kinds of bacteria and create a bigger diverse garden, which will create more resiliency in my personal opinion. Okay, so yeah, so rock dust is more of a long-term end game solution, because over years it will break down and your plants will be healthier. I have many viewers that have used rock dust and they see the results in their garden. That being said, it does need to be broken down. So actually, a better tip that I should have gave in the beginning was add rock dust to your compost pile. Absolutely. Add it to your compost tumblers, which I'm guilty of not doing, only on rare occasions. Actually, that's a good use of my compost. It's micronized because I don't like to breathe it. I'll put it in my compost. It'll be pre-mixed. So yes, that's absolutely the best. Add it actually into your worm mix that you feed your worms so that they could digest it, get it broken down better. Absolutely. I also agree with actually putting it in your soil, because they're going to have different effects, you know. The compost can be more broken down and available, and the stuff you put in your garden will be, you know, more available for food, for chow, for the microbes that are in there now and in future microbes, and also just make your soil better in the future. So that's pretty much my answer on that. I'm going to stick to it. And that's pretty much the end of this month's Q&A. Once again, if you guys have a question for me, I'll post a link down below to my comments tab so you guys can post a question on my community page that may appear in next month's video. Hope you guys are having a fabulous month and doing really great and still gardening despite most of the country being under some kind of cold snap, cold spell. We might even hit 70 in a couple days, which I'm really looking forward to. Want to get this cool shirt? You can check out compassion-tees.com that supports my former editor that used to edit my videos. Also, if you like this video, hey, please be sure to give this video a thumbs up and also share with others that you may think it can help. Also, be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you don't miss out on my new upcoming episodes that come out every 5 to 7 days. You never know where I'll show up or what you'd be learning on my YouTube channel. Also, be sure to click the little bell to get notified as my new videos come out. And finally, be sure to check my past episodes. My past episodes are 1,500 episodes at this time on this YouTube channel dedicated to teaching you guys all about growing high quality food at home. And I have more in-depth, long play videos than any other gardener on YouTube that are really going to give you guys the knowledge you need to be successful to grow. So with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time. And until then, remember, keep on growing.